So you've taken the risk of coming to this session on non-stationary time series. Let's see if we can have some fun. So I'll start with the first principle. Forecasts are always wrong. Then I'll make another claim. So we are going to talk about not just non-stationary time series, we're going to talk about multivariate non-stationary time series. So my claim is there is no other kind of time series. If you have seen others, point those out to me as we go along. So another claim, and I hope I can hold this up over time. And if you dispute with this, please speak up now. Otherwise, it'll haunt you throughout the presentation. The claim is one cannot find a real-world process which is stationary left to itself. If you have found one, then it's violating the second law of thermodynamics. Or it's over a very short period of time that you've checked. Does anybody dispute this? Thank you. Now, if we can't find such a process, then we are stuck with non-stationary time series dealing with them, right? Which a lot of textbooks don't deal with. A lot of publications don't deal with. But the real world, we're stuck with it. We will get into why we're stuck with those. Now, what processes are stationary, if any? Right? You say, well, I see a lot of things mentioned in textbooks and websites about stationary time series. The time series or processes which are tightly controlled, right? For example, when I used to work at Intel Corporation, right, we have the fab processes. Those are very tightly controlled, copy exactly, every parameter tuned, and as soon as it goes out, it's brought back, and so forth. Those processes remain stationary because they're very tightly controlled. And then there's another thing I want to mention about this, right? What you will also see is time series are dealt with as univariate series, right? Now, tell me one process in this world which depends only on itself and nothing else. Any hands? Okay. So why do we deal with things as univariate time series? That's just a question, you know, you may want to answer it to me or to yourself at some point. Now, the stationary time series give the impression of being stationary or the illusion of being stationary because they're being controlled. Now, and the last point, I'll come to it later because that's a sort of summary of this presentation. We'll come back. So now what we will not talk about in this presentation, we'll not talk about seasonal autoregressive moving averages models, which assume homoscedasticity. I can never get to pronounce that right, where the variance of the error does not depend on the value of the variable. So, you know, it's basically constant. So we're not going to talk about those. Or we'll talk about those to say where they're useful, except not quite here. Then we're not going to talk about the generalized autoregressive conditional heteroscedasticity. Okay, you know I don't know how to pronounce that. So we're not going to talk about those. Somebody got a Nobel Prize, two people got a Nobel Prize for that, Engel and Granger. And this was, you know, in economics. Very good thing. This assumes changing variance of noise, right, or changing variance in the error term. And they, if it is autoregressive, they call it the regular autoregressive, and then if it is the generalized one, they include the moving average term. And I'm not going to talk about solving the problem using CNNs or a combination of CNNs and LSTMs and GANs and so forth. People have gotten Turing awards for that. Good. Right? But in the real world, what happens is we have non-stationarity. We need to figure out what are the sources of non-stationarity. And there we will talk about what is possible to do, what is possible not to do. In the real world. We're going to talk about Granger causality. So Clive Granger got a Nobel Prize for that, for the idea of co-integration. So I was mentioning, right, that nothing is stationary by itself, right? But sometimes your non-stationarity may be brought about by somebody or something else. Now, if you just model yourself, you know, so you can difference yourself out and figure out that you're stationary, but then you're making a false model because you actually depend on somebody else who is not stationary. Okay. And then we'll talk about how to model real-world processes. So where you have ideas, you know, pitch in, say, Vikas, this doesn't make sense, all of that, right? So this is more like the wisdom of all of us. And then last one is dynamic mathematical models which are supported by data-driven models. So this is a paradigm I'm proposing is going to take us forward. So I hope I can convince you by the end of this talk that that's possible. This talk is a packed talk. If something doesn't make sense, just you don't have to raise your hand, just say it. Because we're going to go fairly fast through material. Okay. We are also not going to talk about nonlinear dynamics. So we're not going to talk about non-normality, we're not going to talk about aperiodicity, multimodality, nonlinear causal relationships, etc. Okay. We are not going to talk about all of those because that's another fun topic. Okay. I'll mention one of that just right in the beginning, and then we'll just go on. So another day. So now, first of all, where does non-stationarity come from? Now, many of you, some of you who are from physics background or also from engineering background would know this. This is Baker's map or Baker's transformation. This is how I got fat. My wife really knows how to make good patties. Right? So when you make patties, what do? You take dough, you flatten it out, then you fold it over itself, right? And then again flatten it out, again fold it over itself, etc. Now, there are many real-world processes which do this. Now, what this actually does is it causes, let's see if I can play this. You will see right now these two, the points here, some of these points are close together. You see that? And some of those are further apart. Now, you'll see as the transformation, the patty transformation goes through, you'll see some of them get very distant and then suddenly come close together. Right? That's a very classic kind of non-stationarity. So let's go. Hold on. Okay. You see that? So you flatten it out, fold it over itself. Flatten it out, fold it over itself. Flatten it out, fold it. Now, and eventually it almost looks like noise. Eventually it almost looks like noise, but it's not noise because the criterion for maximal information content is the same criterion as, you know, is maximal entropy. The criterion for maximal information content is maximal entropy. So it's very interesting that when you see something which you cannot make sense of, maybe it is coming from other variables. It's not just coming from you. So let's, okay. And here is the hypothesis for all of us to consider. I propose that this comes from processes of, inherent processes of creation and destruction, construction and destruction. So, and I'll illustrate this with a little information theoretic example. So consider this little binary sequence, okay? Now think about this. In the real world, we actually don't see the whole process. So consider that this is the process. Now, in the real world, we always almost never see the whole process, right? We only see the thing that's in front of us. So this is what we see in front of us, right? Now let's say you shift it one bit. Okay? So we shifted this one bit to the left. Notice what happened. The I'm mixed up with left and right. We shifted it one to the right. Right? Now notice what happened. The higher order bit died or went out of my view, and the lower order bit came into view. Right? Now what does that mean? That means that there is some information coming into the system and higher order information is getting destroyed. Right? And you can continue that, right? So in some sense, we are losing macroscopic information, which means if you think in terms of an enterprise and old processes dying, so you're losing old macroscopic information and gaining, or the new information that's coming in, that's still microscopic, but over time it'll become bigger, right? And similarly, there's a process during construction where you do the reverse, right? You shift the bits the other way. Right? So, and then what happens is you're the big bits become bigger and smaller bits become come in, right? So now notice that one man's destruction in another is another man's construction. That's another thing you should note here. Right? So as the information content is brought in or out, you're going to have a system which appears chaotic or uncontrolled. It'll appear like that, right? And this is what's called non-stationary. Now, a stationary process will look like this. There's no shifting here. The information is not coming in, information is not going out. Right? That's a stationary process. Well, so I think I've summarized this. Yeah, I think I've already spoken about this. It's just a summary of what I just spoke. where one understands that you will always see these processes of construction and destruction occurring. New information coming in, old information being destroyed. Not exactly destroyed, it's going into, it's just becoming insignificant in terms of its manifestation. So this example will make it clearer. So if you look at the human system, right, or any process in the world, right, it takes birth. Would you agree? Yes. So there's some information coming in. There is a growth, which is those bits becoming bigger. As you shift the bits, they become bigger, right? And these are also influenced by other processes, which in human world we call education. Then they influence other processes, produce byproducts. Right? So those other processes are getting affected, and some of those other processes get, you know, branched off. Then they are stationary for some time, perhaps a short time, longer time, don't know. Then dwindles. So dwindles is when your bits shift the other side. You see, here the macroscopic bits are becoming bigger. In the other side, the macroscopic bits are becoming smaller, etc. So now notice that the stationary period is quite short here. Right? Most of the time you're in the growth phase or the dwindling phase. Now, then don't we need to know what is happening during that time? Meaning, my claim is that, you know, if you just keep modeling stationary processes, you know, you can't get too much, too far. So we need to do this because we want to control the process, right? And in any complex process, you have complex physics, signals, so you can detect the problem, you can predict something, you can anticipate, control, right? Now for stationary time series, all you need to do is analyze, you know what it is, and then you can do statistical process control, you're all good. So as the world changes, its processes change, time series change. So forecasts for non-stationary series are non-trivial and therefore very valuable. So for example, this time series, climate change. Right? Now, I think this is, for climate change deniers, this is a very interesting slide to show. Right? Notice that this cooling here due to CFC emission reduction was predicted. And because many countries got together, they were able to get it down. Right? So here we have a match of prediction with reality. We have not done so well with CO2. Right? Now, this is a class of models where people have been able to do this successfully. Right? More examples in interactions of finance, CRM, manufacturing, supply chain, acoustic and electrical signals from machines and structures, customer demands, production rates, electricity loads, traffic. So what is stationarity formally? So this will address yours, yes. So strict stationarity is your distribution doesn't change, any number of moments you take, it doesn't change. Okay? Non-stationary is when one of those moments change. So we'll look at the detail with this, I'll skip. Okay? So strict stationarity is the joint distributions of any moments of any degree doesn't change. That doesn't happen in the real world, we'll not bother with that. First order stationarity means that you have means that don't change with time, averages don't change over time. That's also not so common. The third one is second order stationarity, which is a lot more common, where you have a constant mean, variance, and autocovariance that doesn't change with time. And this is where you have different models that people, you know, Box and Jenkins type of models come in. So again, I mentioned this. Okay. Then the second type of stationarity is trend stationarity, which is whether you have linear or quadratic trends, but you keep varying around a trend. So you know, you can model this. Right? And then you have difference stationarity, or I call nth order integration. Right? So you can difference it out and say, now I'm stationary. And the last one is cyclostationarity, or which is seasonality. Right? Now notice I'm still calling all of them stationarity. In textbooks, this will be called non-stationary. Yes. And the reason for that is, once I am able to, so because there are standard tests for this, right? So for each of these, so I can test that out and say, okay, now I have a place where I can model, right? Now, meaning that these are different types of stationarities, right? And I can subtract different terms out and get to stationarity, right? Okay. So, and those are called first order stationarities. Right? So that's what you were referring to, I think, right? So the first order stationarities are these, right? Growth, which is trends, decay, cycles, seasonalities. Now second order is what these guys got a Nobel Prize for. Right? This is 2003 Nobel Prize for John Engel, right? This is the covariance variations, so the G-arch models. Then this is the same varying volatility, periodicity, cyclostationarity. Then higher order, skewness, kurtosis. Then piecewise stationarity, this is very, very common in the enterprise. When you make a change to the process, right? And if you just make it a data-driven model, your model simply will not understand what happened, right? Unless you have a mechanism in place to detect that, right? And it's very hard to detect that. We'll discuss how to detect, okay? So, and intermittency is similar to regime change, which is, you know, when you change some part of the process. Then, of course, you know, you can get into arbitrary variation and so on. That's, you know, another level of detail. So now, one key thing to note is that non-stationarity may not be inherent to the forecasted variable. We mentioned previously that your variable may look like non-stationary, but it may be co-stationary with or co-integrated with some other variable. That was another Nobel Prize for Clive Granger in 2003 also. Now, the kind of models people use for non-stationary time series forecasting. So this is a summary from a paper by Chang King. This is a 2015 paper. The field has not moved too much further beyond this because a lot of focus people have put is on image and NLP. So this hasn't moved too much in this area. So one is the classical autoregressive models, which most of us are likely familiar with. So you have the exponential smoothing, seasonality max is the extended, then vector autoregressive, which is the multivariate version of the ARIMA models, then vector error correction, then you have ARC, we talked about this. The regime switching, piecewise stationary, somebody's going to get a Nobel Prize for this soon, or maybe in a few years. Then you have the GRUs, RNN-based particle filtering, LSTMs. Multivariate LSTMs have become very interesting because what you can do is you can do attention-based, variable attention and temporal attention both. And then there are these frequency domain methods with the Fourier transforms and wavelets going through autoencoders and LSTMs. And then there are methods with saying for short time periods, I'm going to, or for short-term features, I'm going to put that through a CNN and then feed that into LSTMs for longer periods and then feed that into ARIMA models. So people have come up with really, really fancy things. Now, the unfortunate part is that still doesn't work for the industry. And I'll tell you why it doesn't work for the industry. Okay? And then, of course, you have the non-parametric methods like the Bayesian and functional decomposition and so forth. So people have, you know, explored all kinds of combinations of these things. And the reason we are here is because a lot of things, these things don't really work. Right? They work in your research paper, they work when you're, you know, taking your, you know, in fact, in a controlled environment, yes, absolutely. In the research lab, it works beautifully, yes. Okay, so what I'm going to do is, I'm going to go through a couple of these methods, or three of these methods very, very fast, and I'm going to show what's not quite working there. And then we keep going and sort of, okay? All right, so some of you may have seen these autoregressive, integrative, moving average models, okay? So different types of models. So the autoregressive filter, oops, sorry, I shouldn't stand in front of this. I should just point to it. Okay, so that takes care of your long-term trends. The moving averages filter is very interesting because it takes care of your shock or error term, right? And if there is a process, if your process is such that these error terms keep adding up, as in they don't just get averaged out, that is an example of a non-stationary process. It permanently shifts your mean. Okay. And the integration filter is actually very interesting. Right? The integration filter is telling you that I have an inherent polynomial behind me. I have an inherent polynomial. Now, what this does is, see, when you're taking your, so see, people say you difference it out as long as you want. So pro tip, do not do that. If you are having to differentiate out more than twice, you're going to make your model unstable. We can get into the details of why it would be unstable, but in short, you do one or two, and you, once you go to third, fourth, your model is just, it doesn't know what it's doing. So if you're having to do two, more than two, that means it's not really, meaning your time series is not non-stationary, it's depending on five other variables, which may also have their own levels of integration. So it's time to bring in other variables. Okay. So now, this is well studied, and if you like more details, I like this article on Analytics Vidya. So I had given a talk on data hack, and then 15 days later, they put up this beautiful article on non-stationary time series. It's a really good article. I highly recommend it if you like an overview of some of these things. Right? Now, how do you test for non-stationarity? Now, each process, you know, these equations, right? Each of these equations has a characteristic function. You know, any polynomial, now if you've solved polynomials, you know, finding roots of polynomials, polynomials have characteristic functions. Characteristic functions have roots. Right? Now, if your characteristic function has a root equal to 1, then what's happening is, in the simplest terms, right, what is happening is your yn plus 1 equals yn plus something. Right? So what is happening is your error keeps accumulating. Your error keeps accumulating over time. So basically, you keep going further and further away from the original process. Now, if you do your differencing on this one, right, and then you find that all other roots of the process are less than 1, that means the process will stay around a certain mean and within a certain variance. Right? So the standard test for this is Dickey-Fuller test, available in most packages. As you know, you might know. Now, if the process has a root greater than 1, then you know that you have trouble. It's an explosive process. Somebody needs to fix it. Or maybe your video is going viral. So, depending on what you're modeling. Right? Now, there are other extensions to this, which many of you may also be familiar with, which is you can have models with seasonal components, which nearly everybody uses nowadays. Right? Now, models with side information. Now, this is the beginning of where you're using other variables. Right? So, in the econometrics world, they are called ARIMA with an extension. And the extension is you add another term for another variable, right? Y and another X or a set of X's. Right? Now, this models with long-term memory is very interesting. I wish I had the time to discuss this. Right? So, we talk about integration, then these are fractional integration models. These are also very interesting. Now, we will talk about briefly for multivariate time series, because these do address the issue of multivariate, but they don't address the issue of the non-stationarity. It still expects the individual time series to be either co-integrated or stationary, meaning in themselves. Now, the G-arch process. Now, this one, I don't know, I think I should skip this in the interest of time. Because I mentioned it in principle that it is modeling the change in variance. So maybe I'll just show this, right? So what are we doing? We are modeling the change in variance as a autoregressive and moving average process. Change in the variance of the error. Change in the variance, yeah. In short, they are modeling the change in the variance of the error term. And that gets you to that second order. These slides will be available. It's purposely made as a chart here, but this shows you where do you use which type of model, simply stated, right? So some of them, most of them actually, are linear, but some of them have non-linearities that you can use, neural networks obviously, right? So, but we're going to skip this for now. Please look at it at your own leisure, you know, as like a simple guide. Okay, so now the question is, I have motivated this question before, that there is no variable which is dependent only upon itself. So why multivariate? Yes, in fact, you know, the Baker's map that I showed comes from deterministic chaos theory. Exactly, yes. So this is a crazy world to be in. Yes, indeed. Yes. So this used to be the domain of physicists and so forth. Yes, indeed. And those of you who are physicists would likely know this. Okay, so this I have talked about, that, you know, give an example of a real process that is not affected by anything else, and we were not able to find that thus far. So similarly, there's nothing in an enterprise that works on its own, right? Sales will depend on the demand, it'll depend on the production, it'll depend on how many people we have hired, it depends on my suppliers, it depends on so many things. So how can I model sales as an autoregressive process? It just doesn't make sense, right? Same way for revenue. What to speak of the stock market? People, there was a time where people were modeling the stock market as an ARIMA process. And I was like, what? partly due to the availability of computational resources. Right? You know, there was a time where people were doing these by hand, so we have to brand them back. Okay, so this is Clive Granger. Now, his point is that in the real world, each process is an outcome of a nonlinear, like possibly nonlinear combination. We're not going to talk about nonlinear combinations today, as we said before. Today we're going to talk about mostly linear combinations, but future. Because first we handle linear, then we go to nonlinear. Because nonlinear really gets into chaos. Okay. So they might have mutual delays and shock events. Now, this is his key insight. This is what he got the Nobel Prize for. That non-stationarity in a single time series may be simply a co-integration of multiple time series. So, and we'll show you what co-integration is. Now, so this has been well known in statistics for many years, but it came to econometrics later on, so the guy got a Nobel Prize. And this is what I was saying earlier about differencing, right? So the problem with differencing, and you say, I got a stationary series. The problem with that is, after your second level of differencing, you're at a risk of chaotic behavior. And why is that chaotic behavior? Because what you are considering as error terms are not really error terms at all. Those are coming from other variables. It may be computationally easy, right? Like, you know, if I'm looking for my keys, right? There's light here, I can look under here, but I lost it under the tree outside. So I have to look for the key under the tree. So like we said earlier, the apparent non-stationarity could be due to contributing variables. So what is co-integration? If two time series are co-integrated, there is a value beta 1 and beta 2 which is stationary, which has a less than 1 root or non-unity root process. And you can regress yt on xt. How do you find this? Right? You can regress yt on xt, and on the residuals, you take the augmented Dickey-Fuller test. Again, great place to look for this is on that analytics with the article. Now, this is from the research papers. So this is multivariate time series model. We're talking about the VAR models, right? Vector autoregressive. Okay? So basically, we said y1 depends on yt minus 1 and so forth, and it also depends on x's. You can transform the non-stationary series into stationary ones, but if you can't, oops, you don't go forward with this. It doesn't go anywhere. You can still apply it that if they're not co-integrated, but they still have to be stationary. And then, you know, the problem is if you're not stationary, then you're in trouble because the assumptions don't apply anymore, right?
So in most of the times in reality, we just change the problem statement so that we don't have to deal with this non-stationary.
Yes. Yeah. So in fact, that's coming. That's coming. Yes. See, sometimes it's like, you know, when somebody is doing a PhD, right? They take the Holy Grail, right? They start off. Like, I also started off like that. Okay. So then, most of what I was supposed to do, over the period of time, my thesis committee, you know, helped me change the problem to something, make it more tractable, right? And once we had 5 papers, we said staple it together, and that's the PhD thesis. Right? And then all the Holy Grail went into future work. Right? So you can do that, right? If you have the 5 papers. So now people have proposed temporal causal models based on Granger causality. Now the problem with these models is these are computationally intractable, because what you need to do is you need to keep shifting. So let's say you have 4 time series. You need to keep shifting each one with respect to the other and say, where do they fit? Right? Maybe it's a combinatorially. So of course, causality, everybody knows, you know, if you take So the statement of danger causality, which will come later, if y is predicted better by x than only by y, then x is a cause of y. That's Granger's point. Okay, you may not agree with him, but the guy got a Nobel Prize. Okay, but it kind of makes sense, right? If x is a better predictor of y than y itself, then x is likely a predictor of y. I mean, if you, after his insight, it sounds like a tautology, but okay. So I think I'm going to skip this because that's basically what this is saying in mathematical terms. What do you do to create this temporally dynamic network or relationship? You create a time-dependent network. This was a sales and revenue example, right? So now notice that multiple things affect this, multiple things affect this. So this is a Tegramite package which you can, all of you can download. Now the fun thing about this is, Jacob Runge, he came up with this idea that I'm not going to use any time series. What I'm going to do is, he created four differential equations and basically simulated them and said that this is my time series. Okay? And those are obviously all stationary and it's all beautiful. So it works for that. It totally works for that. Now the challenge, and so he's able to discover, so this is my own diagram, but in his diagram he's also able to find those kinds of relationships. But in the real world, guess what? The world doesn't work like, you know, differential equations generated time series. So if your data is so nice, you can probably, you know, take his package, run with it. Right? But this is good stuff. This is good stuff because he's building up on Clive Granger's work. It's a nice package. One can extend it probably to other scenarios. But the key thing to note from this figure, that one thing influences many other things. Multiple things influence one thing, right? So you cannot, for example, production in a factory, right? You cannot say my factory is the production in my factory is an Arima process, right? You know, that would be incredibly naive to do, right? Because it depends on your suppliers, it depends on your vendors, it depends on your downtime, it depends on your shipping, it depends on your inventory, etc. Skip this. Skip. Yes. How do we deal with non-stationarity then, right? Because so far we've just said what doesn't work, okay? All right, so one way to deal with non-stationarity, which Professor João Gama in Portugal has proposed, is we can use KL divergence tests on multiple windows of the data, right? So you know, as the data keeps coming in, you keep windowing it, or you do your exponential decay or whichever choice you have in the matter, and you can keep doing KL divergences, and when there is a divergence you change your model. When there's you set a threshold how much divergence is acceptable to you, and then you change your model. So what you are doing essentially is you are learning from the past based on time shifting, windowing and waiting techniques. The challenge with this is, how do you create those windows? Who sets those thresholds for the shifts? I'm not going to sit down and do it, and neither are you. Okay, what to do? Now, okay, so then for people in this conference, a lot of people will tell you, just go to LSTMs. That'll solve all your problems with time series. It's just, because LSTMs don't require the non-stationarity assumption. Stationarity assumption. They can work with anything. Okay, all right. So now this is where I'm going to ask you, should I talk about LSTMs? Now, okay, so we'll come back and talk about LSTMs because I still want to give you the overall solution because they're going to kick me out after 5 minutes. Because this presentation you will have, the animations you will have, okay? So this shows how the information flows in LSTM and how it works. But I am going to say, okay, people have tried to do this aircraft engine failure. This is from Microsoft. They wanted to show how things work in Azure. Now the challenge is that they're doing this without an actual model of the aircraft engine, right? They're trying to just do straight LSTM problem. Note that, why I'll tell you why that's a problem. Then you have this idea of multivariable LSTMs with both temporal attention and variable attention. Now, if you are going to do blind time series, I have found this very useful for lab data. Beautiful for lab data. If you want real data, you will still be in trouble. Because remember, when we make forecasts from these models, we are going to make decisions based on that, which may change what is happening in our factory, which may change what's happening in my aircraft, which may change change what is happening in my distribution system. So I cannot have them at 70% accuracy. I cannot have them at 70. I need them at 99%. Okay. So what do? We still have a problem. What to do? So that's why Niels Bohr said prediction is very difficult, especially about the future. That's where your point comes in, which is whenever possible, formulate the problem in a different way. Okay, and here is a different formulation of the problem. So a different formulation of the problem is that usually in an industrial situation, we often know we have some knowledge about the relationships that exist. Our knowledge may not be perfect, but we at least know that, and well for some it's almost perfect, right? I know that sales is directly correlated with revenue. Right? Meaning it's literally Y is equal to MX plus C. Right? So there are some relationships like that, and then there are some non-linear relationships. So the recommendation here, which I have, you know, I wish I had, next time we'll do a 5-day workshop on this. What I've seen work in my short experience is, let us create a hypothesis of what's happening in the real world. So that's one model. Now, GE, MathWorks, they call it a digital twin. You've heard of that? Yes. So now people poo-poo that thing, okay? You know, especially if you're doing deep learning, you'll be like, I can do everything with that. Okay. Now there's a challenge with that because, okay. Anyway, let me not get into the challenges. We'll afterwards. So the example of in insurance, right? Now what you do is you create a partial delay differential equations based network of relationships. So partial differential equations, most people will know. Partial delay differential equations, you have explicit terms for time delays, right? Which are not often, because you cannot always account for why there's a difference in time. So you explicitly include those. Okay? And then you create that network of relationships like this one, right? So in some cases, initially I may just put it as a linear relationship, I don't know, right? And in fact, if I don't know at all, I may use a deep learning system. On top of that, do my Shapley values, and then you take your deep learning model and you create it for one variable against the other, one variable against the others, right? And by that, you can get the Shapley values of the, so essentially you find out the derivatives of each variable with respect to the other, right? That will only tell you the first order information. But let's start with first order. We don't have second order anyway. Let's start somewhere, right? So once we have this kind of network, right, the deep learning system can tell me, it's almost like an adversarial network. This is my differential equation-based network. This is the kind of thing that Viral Shah was saying the first day, right? Differentiable programming, right? So this is one network. This generates something. There's another model which generates something. You see where's the difference. And that's where you do your reinforcement. Right? You say, wait a minute, what is it that I change here that will make me match the other one? What is it? Go ahead. Yeah. Afterwards. Yes, we'll do that afterwards. Right? So what we do is we create these two models. We use the partial delay differential equation model to create and test hypotheses, simulate predictions. Then you keep correcting that model. See, this model is the one that goes in production, not the deep learning one, because the regulators will kill you. Okay. And then there's one more thing you can do with this. 2 minutes. Okay. So you find the highest content information content experiments, because you can run a Monte Carlo simulation on this PDDE, and you can say which experiments will get me the maximum information about these relationships. Some experiments will be a waste, so I'm not going to even get that data. But now I know where to get information from, right? And then I can keep building my model and et cetera. Right? Now this works extremely well in enterprise situations compared to the plain vanilla machine learning based models. So in short, in the real world, we can only predict for a short time, even if we know everything perfectly. We showed that in the Baker's map. The purely database method, which are purely machine learning methods, fail. Purely knowledge-based method fail. So what you need to do is we need to combine your existing knowledge, which was the point Viral Shah also made on in the differentiable programming one, that you need to combine your domain knowledge. Because see, if you throw away domain knowledge, you have to relearn it all over again. And you keep going, and your ball is walking on the ceiling and all that. So if you want to avoid that, you have to encode that ahead of time, right? And then you can improve the model by finding experiments for the highest information content. I wish I could show you this fun stuff, but another time. Thank you very much for your time. Questions, comments, criticisms, problems. It is fundamentally, see, fundamentally, everything is Bayesian inference. Because we are trying to approximate Bayesian inference. Yes, agreed, totally. And of course, I'm around, so if you want to give me tips of how I can improve in this, let me know.